Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
ECM. Well, kind of
technically.
Good evening. All right. Well, we're all glad you're here tonight. Thank you for coming and eating. Parker and his dad made food tonight. So it was sponsored by Northside Baptist Church, which is Parker's church. So thank y'all for that. So tonight, for our announcements, we have the BCM Remind. If you're not signed up for this, it gives out a lot of helpful information. We'll remind you about services each Monday, just to make sure you're aware that they're going on. Also, there's lots of community events that we host on Remind to remind you about, volunteer opportunities, things like that. Next is the BCM Talent Show. That is next Tuesday, February 7th at 7 o'clock. 7-7. We need one more 7. It would be... All right. So, next is the... All right. So, we want you all to dress up in Western wear. That means cowboy boots, your cowboy hat, all kinds of stuff. Chaps if you got them, anything. Just come all decked out. Yes, Nick.
Can I bring my repeating revolver with me?
Let's leave that at home. All right. Next, we also are selling tickets, 2 for $5 or 1 for $3. So if you bring a friend, you get a discount.
Bring a friend.
Also, it's $5 at the door.
$5 at the door. Also, they could be limited.
They could be limited.
So you might not get in if you don't buy first. Yes, in the chapel. Pack out the chapel.
What about the balcony?
Pack out the balcony. It's a lot of fun. I guarantee you, you'll have plenty of laughs.
And Will is emceeing, so.
Yes.
And my.
It's
a woman there.
All right.
Will's in the room.
Next, we are kind of kicking off our first of the I Am statements tonight, or the He Is, as we like to say. So this is a 6-week journey through John, and we will be looking at the I Am statements. Mr. Ken Whitlow is going to be speaking for us tonight, so prepare for him. And we're also going to start to have worship here in just a few minutes. And D-Rol wants to talk about BCM Day.
D-Rol!
Need your help. We got a lot of churches that have requested a student to come share a 5-minute testimony, and I'm going to give you some talking points. And it's just for something very basic of thanking them for their support, because churches like bring our food and help us with our budget, and they pray for us and help us with mission stuff and all that kind of. So, it's just a way of saying thanks, but also just how God's working in your life here through BCM. And it could be talk about a mission trip, it could be Bible study, worship, whatever you, however God is using us. And I pray that He's working through us here each week and each year. So, just is that sign up over there? Oh, here. The sign up for the BCM Day. We had it last week. We'll get one. I need your email cell, but I got several of you going, so.
Just write it on a BCM card.
Yeah.
Blue BCM card.
Because I'll send you an email, and if you got any questions, talk to me tonight. Stop nothing. Just different churches, like one on Shorter Avenue, one is Parker's going out north side, First Lindale. It's just all churches right around Rome, so it's just a good opportunity. Okay, so look forward to talking with every one of you afterwards. All right, I'm going to introduce Mr. Whitlow, or no? I'm going to sing.
Can I sing with you?
You don't know the song, though. Be tender with my love. You know how easy it is to love. You know who sings that?
Very young thing on with David Roll.
That's a Bee Gees song.
Oh.
We're going downhill quickly. I gotta bring this back. Hey. Alright, settle down. I got riled up. Ken Whitlow is just a great guy, a key of student affairs. I think he really is an advocate for you here at Ford. And he went on our mission trip in December, and he just does a lot of things behind the scenes that you don't get to see, but we're glad to. He used to serve as a pastor. He's been on church staff here at Pleasant Valley South before he came here to Shorter. So he's just a good listener and someone you can always turn to, and especially if you got something going on. So if you do bring any kind of weapon, then you'll be seen. Then you'll be in trouble. But, no. Thank you. Anyway, Ken, we look forward to hearing you hear what God has laid on your heart. Let's pray, and I think then the worship team is coming up. Thank you, Father, for tonight and for these students, for their laughter, also for their willingness to lead worship, their willingness to serve, their willingness to lead, to be examples, to share their faith. Thank you for the opportunity that we can have to grow in our faith as a result of not just being in this room on Monday nights, but also in the Word, in discipleship, activities, fun stuff. God, you use all of that. So help us to be instruments of your love and grace, even this week on our campus, as we boldly proclaim who you are and how you've changed our lives. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
So as we start out tonight and we redirect our focus toward worship, this first song we're going to do tonight is one that we haven't done at BCM since I've been here. But I went to a conference this past Tuesday in Huntsville, and it was like being at revival, and it was absolutely amazing. And something, God moved on me in a special way, and I had been really wanting a touch from the Lord, and something that God wants us to do, you know, no matter what, is to rejoice in Him. So I wanted to give you Philippians 4:4, to rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I would say rejoice. Because sometimes in life, we may look at our circumstances and think, well, you know, how am I supposed to, you know, praise the Lord in this moment? But when we praise Him before we see the breakthrough, that's like, it's like, you know, we're putting faith into it. Faith is what plugs into the power source of the Holy Spirit. And it's very important for us to remember that God is faithful. You know, we may fail at times, we may make mistakes, but God is always faithful. And that's the point of this song tonight, is that He won't fail. No matter how difficult a circumstance may look like, on the good days and the bad days, God's always there with you. He's right next to you. He never leaves you. He doesn't send you out to the fight alone. And when the rain comes, I told Lauren about this, but as we drove home from the service on Tuesday, it rained the whole way home. And I was like telling my parents, I'm like, the Holy Spirit's giving us the physical sign that He's sending the rain. Because we had the spiritual rain, and now we got the physical rain. So if you all just stand as we worship tonight, it's just a time to rejoice. I'm very excited for what God's going to do tonight, because we have Ken speak to us, and just to see God move.
Thank you.
it's his breath in our lungs that allows us to sing, right? So we're going to sing Hallelujah. Gave me this song tonight. This one's called Blessed Redeemer. And as I was reading through the lyrics before tonight, I was reminded of how powerful the blood of Jesus is that he shed for us, how powerful that is, and how we should never forget that. Never forget the wonderful sacrifice that Jesus made for us. What a beautiful thing it is that God would send his only son for you, and even just for you. If you were the only person on this earth, he would still do it just for you, because he loves you that much. Weary and give and give and give. You ask us to receive. We don't earn our salvation. We don't earn your grace, that you give it freely as a gift. And I'm thankful that we get to receive that gift every single day. And I pray that you would bring healing to who needs healing mentally, physically, emotionally, and that you would bring peace to those who need peace. In Jesus' name.
You may be seated. Please welcome our speaker.
Good evening, everybody. It's good to see y'all. I feel like I'm doing something illegal tonight. I'm not used to being out this late on Monday night. So they say nothing good happens after midnight. Well, when you get mine and David's age, nothing good happens after about 8 o'clock at night. But my wife knows where I am, so I'm not breaking curfew or anything like that.
You can come in later.
I can come in. All right. Yeah, I get to come in a little late tomorrow. Okay, that sounds good. I noticed y'all all have on your name tags, like your name, and then I think it's like your favorite spot on campus. Is that what it is? Okay. My favorite spot on campus is David's office, because I know that's somewhere I can always go and be alone. When I need some quiet time, I always go, I know I can go to his office because he's not going to be there. And I can just close the door and close the blinds.
What
are
you guys?
Just chill out. So, if you're ever looking for a quiet place on campus, campus minister's office is always available. Okay? But it's great to be here tonight. I appreciate David, Andrew, and whoever else was behind it asking me to come and share with you a little bit tonight. You're starting, I think tonight's really the first night where you're talking about the I Am statements of Jesus. And I was asked to address a couple of them, I Am the Bread of Life and then I Am the Resurrection. So we're going to talk a little bit about those tonight. Some of the things, as we start thinking about that, thousands of years after the cross, many of us having been raised in church, going to a Christian school and that kind of thing, we read these statements in the Gospels and we just go, yeah, Jesus said that, I'm the bread of life, or I'm the resurrection, or I'm the whatever, and it just, I'm not sure we really take time to really think about, wow, what does that really mean? And then, nor are we very good about kind of getting ourselves back into that day when he actually said that to a group of people, and then just going, that is a really weird thing to say, because when you think about some of these statements, had you or I been standing in the crowd that Jesus said those to, we would have thought, that's really weird. What in the world is he talking about? What kind of lunatic is this? Boy, he doesn't think too much of himself, does he? So those would have been some of the reactions that people would have had. And I think it's important for us to think about that, because sometimes I think we forget that this stuff really happened and that Jesus really said it. And he said it to real people who really and truly weren't probably all that different from you and me in how they would respond or how they would react, and also in what they were looking for in life, in how they were just trying to make their way through this world and make it from one day to the next. And so some of the things that you're going to think about and you're going to talk about in these next few weeks I want you to understand that when they were said in that original time when Jesus really said them, people were probably scratching their heads. And that's because they were unusual things. They're deep things, and they're things that we really need to think about. Well, what does that really mean? What is he really saying there? And as I thought about how to approach these two issues, I thought, well, let's just kind of read through the text here and just try to make some really simple points about this. But I want to start with when I got married, my wife's name is Tracy. Maybe some of y'all have met her, but Tracy and I have been married, we'll be married 33 years in May. And when we got married all those years ago, I realized, of course, that our two family traditions and habits were coming together and that kind of thing, what we were used to. And I realized that there would be some give and take there, you know. Her family doesn't do things the way my family does it. They're wrong about everything, And my family doesn't do things the way hers does and that kind of thing. So I told Tracy, I said, Tracy, there's two things you've got to learn to do like my family does. Just two things. Now, before I go on, I got to tell you, my mother was the best cook in the world. I know you think your mother is, I know you think your grandmother is, but I'm telling you, you're wrong, because it was my mother. My mother was the best cook that's ever lived. And my mother, this is not an exaggeration, but just about every day of the week, my mother made homemade biscuits. And we had them for supper at night, and then what was left over, I got up the next morning, and I'd warm up one of those biscuits and put a slice of cheese in it and just have a cheese biscuit in the morning. But there were always biscuits around my house when I was growing up. And so I told Tracy, I said, Tracy, there's two things you got to learn to do like my family does, or make like my mother makes. One of them is sweet tea, because my family drank really sweet tea. And the other is you got to learn how to make biscuits like my mother makes biscuits. And guess what? Tracy did it. She learned how to make sweet tea, like my family made. And she learned how to, my mother went over, several many times with my mom before we got married and learned how to make homemade biscuits the way my mom did. And so we got started in our marriage, and she, for probably about the first 2 years, she made sweet tea the way my family made it and homemade biscuits the way my mother made it, and then she quit. And I'm glad she did, because drinking all that sweet tea and eating all those homemade biscuits wasn't probably good for me. But I say that to say that bread has been a staple in my diet, just like it has been probably in your diet, and just like it is in most diets around the world. Bread is a staple. Bread is a basic. I mean, you can go just about anywhere in the world, and you're going to eat some type or some form of bread. It might be like sliced bread like we have. It might be a bun. It might be pita bread. It's all kinds of things. But bread is a staple across the world. And so when Jesus made the statement that he did about being the bread of life, that was something that people could identify with. And so we're going to be in John chapter 6 as we begin tonight, talking about this issue of Jesus being the bread of life. Now, as you're finding that, if you want to find that in your Bibles, on your phones, whatever, what we're going to be reading, the context is, or the setting is that Jesus is teaching in the region of the Sea of Galilee, up in the north part of Israel. And what we're going to read in John chapter 6, we're going to read the last half of the chapter, comes on the heels of him feeding the 5,000. You're familiar with that story. Jesus was teaching at the Sea of Galilee. This large crowd gathers, and then we're told in the Bible that there were how many? 5,000. 5,000 who or what? 5,000 men. Which means probably that the crowd actually was bigger than 5,000. Okay, they only counted the men back in those days. And so we don't really know how big this crowd was, but let's just suffice it to say it was a big crowd. There were a lot of people there listening to Jesus teach. And Jesus gathers his disciples. He says, hey guys, it's getting late in the day. We've been out here teaching. These people are hungry. We need to feed them. What do we have to feed them? And they just look at Jesus like, what do you mean, what do we have? First of all, we could never begin to afford to feed these people. I mean, Jesus, there's like 5,000 men here. We're not even counting the women and children. There's no way we can feed these people. Now, Jesus knows what he's going to do. And you know the story. One of them comes in and says, well, it'd take like a year's worth of wages to feed all these people. And then another one comes and says, well, I'll tell you what. There's one kid here whose mom packed him a sack lunch. Think about this. It's just even ridiculous that the guy even brought this up, isn't it? I mean, would you have been the one? I mean, I wouldn't have been brave enough to be with the disciple that said, you know, Jesus, we got a kid here with a sack lunch. And he's got some fish, and he's got, you know, he's got a bread, he's got like a fish sandwich, you know. And I wouldn't have even mentioned it, because it'd be like, what's the use? But Jesus says, sounds good. And he says, go get it and bring it to me. So they go, can you imagine taking the lunch from this little kid? I mean, you know, how mean is that, taking this kid's sack lunch. And so they bring it to Jesus, and we know, you know the story. What did Jesus do? He blessed it, he broke it, and he said, all right, y'all start passing it out. I mean, they probably thought, man, this is the most ridiculous thing. We got like, you know, a couple of people, a few pieces of bread and some fish here. And they go start passing it out, and it just keeps going and going and going and going and going. Finally, everybody's eaten. Not have they done only, have they just had a little bit. They've had all they wanted. I had all they wanted. And Jesus says, okay, now, and collect up the leftovers. And they have all this stuff left over. And so everybody's pretty impressed. The crowd's pretty impressed by that. All of us would have been. And so he finishes teaching, closes the service, dismisses everybody. And then we're told that night, the disciples got in the boat. You know, Jesus tells, hey, get in the boat, go across the lake. We're going to teach on the other side of the lake tomorrow. So y'all go on, I'll catch up with you. And so they go, get in the boat, and they take off, and they're rowing across. And what happens after that? Storm. And then they're fighting against the wind and the waves, and they see something in the distance, and they're like, what? What is it? It's Jesus walking on the water, right? So that's when he calms them, calms the sea, and all that kind of stuff. So they get to the other side of the lake, and it's the next day. And what happens? Well, that's where we pick it up in verse 25, because the crowd got up the next day, and they're wondering, where is this guy? You know, where's the bread guy? And so they're like, he left, and well, maybe he went... Maybe he went to the other side of the lake, so they truck it over there, okay? Boats, probably walking, whatever, they get over there. And in verse 25, it says, and this is sort of the crowd speaking, it says, when they found Jesus on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you get here? You know, they're trying to play it off. Like, oh man, you know, we didn't know you were coming up here with this, but they knew what they were doing. And so they said, Rabbi, when did you get here? And Jesus answered them and said, truly, truly, I say to you, you seek me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not work for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you, for on him the Father, God, has set his seal. So the crowd is doing what people do. They're wanting their physical needs met. They have found this guy that by some way he is able to take a sack lunch and just bread just start showing up from everywhere. Now, before we're too harsh on these folks, we got to remember, they didn't have it like we do. I'm not the least bit worried about where my next meal is coming from. Because I know that if every grocery store in Rome shuts down for the next month, I've got enough food in my house to where I'm not going to starve. Because our food supply is very secure, okay? We know that. For them, though, it was different in that day. I'm not saying these people were starving or anything like that. I'm not saying there was a famine going on. But in that day, the food supply was not as secure as what we know. And so... naturally, they think, wow, you know, here's a guy, I don't know how he does it, but I know that he fed us, and there was plenty, and sometimes we have a hard time making ends meet and having enough food, and so maybe this is a good thing. And so they go find him, and of course, they're thinking just about their physical needs, but what does Jesus do? He says, wait a minute, you're thinking on the wrong level. Jesus always does this. He did it with his disciples. He did it when he was teaching with the crowd. He always did it. He did it when he was encountering the Pharisees or whoever it was. He would redirect and say, but what's the real issue here? And he points them to the spiritual issue. says you came because you ate the bread and you're just thinking that you just want your next meal, but there's something deeper going on here that you really need to think about. So let's pick it back up in verse 28. It says, therefore they said to him, what shall we do so that we may work the works of God? Jesus answered and said to them, this is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent. So they said to him, what then do you do for a sign so that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform? Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread out of heaven to eat. Are you familiar with that story? You know what Jesus is talking about there. That's when Moses was leading the people out of Egyptian slavery. They're out wandering around in the wilderness. They don't have any food. They're like, Moses, we're hungry. Why'd you bring us out here just to die? Well, there's just not enough place to bury us all in Egypt. And they grumbled and they griped. We don't have any food. We'd be better off back there. And God says, okay, Moses, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to have manna and quail come down every day. And he'd tell the people to go out and pick up what they need for the day. But just what they need for the day. And so manna was this type of bread that they would find. Now, they thought that Moses did that. What they didn't realize was that was God who did that. And so that's the context that this crowd is thinking about this. And then Jesus says to them in verse 32, truly, truly, I say to you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread out of heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread out of heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down out of heaven and gives life to the world. Now we're getting near to what Jesus is going to say here. He says, then they said to him, Lord, always give us this bread. Jesus' response, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will not hunger, and he who believes in me will never thirst. So there we have it. Jesus looks at this crowd, and they're like Rabbi, we want this bread that you're talking about. And he says, and I can only imagine how this hit the crowd, he says, I'm the bread of life. And that is, just think of how people would have received that statement. Think of how, and that, please don't think I'm accusing Jesus of a sin here, okay? But think of how arrogant that statement must have sounded to a group of normal people like us back in the first century, and a guy says, I'm the bread of life. If I walked in this room tonight and I told y'all, good evening, everyone. My name is Ken Whitlow. I'm the bread of life. What would you think? Yeah, you would think I was a nut. I know you would. And you should. You should. Okay? But so Jesus makes this statement. So what does he mean? What is he talking about? What does it mean that Jesus is the bread of life? I just want to point out three things, okay, about Jesus being the bread of life. And I think there's a whole lot more that can be said about this. This is one of those things where when you think about Jesus being the bread of life, you probably could talk about it for, you know, 2 or 3 weeks and not exhaust the topic. So I'm just going to, three thoughts that come to my mind. Number one, and they're all kind of here in the text. Number one, what does it mean that Jesus is the bread of life? It means that he is our satisfaction. It means that we find our satisfaction in him. In verse 35, he says, he who comes to me will not hunger. I don't know what your favorite meal is. My favorite meal, if I had to choose the last meal, would be this. Country fried steak, mashed potatoes, black-eyed peas, homemade biscuit, and probably something like key lime pie. With a glass of sweet tea that I don't drink. And that probably, but as much as I enjoy that, I know that it's only going to last so long and I'm going to get hungry again. That's the one thing I know. Sometimes we Americans, we're eating one meal and we're already thinking about the next meal. My father-in-law was that kind of guy. He wasn't interested in, you know, it's like, it wasn't even lunchtime and he was wanting to know what was going to be for supper. It was supper time and he was saying, hey, what are we going to have for breakfast in the morning? He was always thinking about the next one. But Jesus is our satisfaction. What I think that means is that Jesus fulfills our every need our every desire, our every drive, our every want in life.
He's our sustainer.
What?
He's our sustainer.
He is our sustainer, exactly. But he fulfills our every need, our every desire, our every drive. And what does the world do? The world tries to convince you that you are nothing more than your needs, your wants, your desires, and your drives. That's all you are. And then it turns around and says, and you know what? We have a newer, better way to fulfill your needs, your wants, your desires, and your drives. So what is it doing? It's telling you all you are is you're the sum of your needs, your wants, your drives, your desires. And then it's turned around and saying, but you know what? Your needs, your wants, your desires, and drives are never really fully fulfilled except unless you drink this, or you take that, or you do this, or you go there. So it's always keeping you stirred up, and you're never satisfied. Because you think, well, there's got to be something more. Maybe I need to try that. Maybe I need to go there. Maybe I need to do this. But what I think it means that Jesus is the bread of life is that in Jesus, there's a difference there. In Jesus is complete satisfaction. There are some people who are satisfied with Jesus. But it's a different thing to be satisfied in Jesus. See, when you're satisfied with Jesus, it's just kind of like, oh yeah, he's cool. I like the things that Jesus said. You know, but it's still about my wants, my desires, my drives, my needs. But when you're satisfied in Jesus, you realize that he does sustain you through all things, that he does complete you, that there is nothing that you could ever need, want, desire that Jesus will not fulfill, that cannot be met in the way that God would want to meet them. So let me ask you a question. If everything in your life over the next few months, if everything in your life fell away, your health, your family, your intelligence, your looks, whatever it is, you know, that you think, man, that just really gives my life meaning. If everything fell away except for your relationship with Jesus, would you be satisfied? Could you be satisfied? Could you be satisfied just with Jesus? Jesus being the bread of life, it means that we find our satisfaction in him. He says, those who come to me will never hunger, they will not hunger, and he who believes in me will never thirst. But then he goes on and he continues. And he says in verse 36, but I said to you that you have seen me and yet you do not believe. Verse 37, all that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me I will certainly not cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. This is the will of him who sent me, that of all that he has given me, I lose nothing but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who beholds the Son and believes in him will have eternal life, and I myself will raise him up on the last day. So in verse 37 through 40, we see that Jesus as the bread of life is our security. He's our security. Because of Jesus, we can know that our standing with God is secure. That is not going to change from day to day. There's really no other belief system in the world that can bring real security and real peace. Because ultimately what people are looking for is they're looking for security and peace in their lives. You know, people characterize it different ways. I'm looking for inner security or inner peace. I'm looking for peace with my maker. I'm looking for peace with my fellow man. They're looking for that. They're looking for security and peace. And there really is no other system of belief outside of Christianity that really produces a sense of security. And the reason is that most of them lean towards what we as Christians call a works-based salvation. a works-based security, a works-based peace with whoever it is that you think is out there. And the thing about works is that that's nothing more, and we human beings we're really good at doing this. We always find ways to turn things back on ourselves and make them about ourselves. See, because a works-based way of finding peace or of knowing God, that makes it about me, not about Him. That's why so many people in our society today, it's like, oh yeah, I know God. I'm a Christian. I know God. And what they do is they fold Him up and they tuck Him in their pocket and they walk around with Him. They're like, yeah, I got God. He's right here in my pocket. And what I do is I pull Him out when I need Him, but otherwise it's all about me. You know, when I get in a tight spot, I pull Him out and I'm like, oh, here's God. He'll get me out of this jam. And then I'm going to stick Him back in my pocket and just carry Him around with me, because it's really all about who I am and what I do and what I don't do. And that's about like the stock market. The stock market's up one day and it's down the next. It's up one day and it's down the next. It's up for a week, it's down for 2 weeks. And that's what a works-based salvation really is like. How are you ever going to know? How are you ever going to know when you've been good enough? How are you ever going to know when you haven't committed the one sin that you can't come back from? There is no security. There is no peace outside of Jesus and the satisfaction that we have in Him. Even in the Old Testament, under the Old Testament law, it didn't really bring security. Read the Old Testament. Think about it. You can just get the sense that there never was this understanding in the minds of the people that they had made the sacrifice that they needed to make and they wouldn't need to make anymore. Because every time you went to the temple and you took, you know, the unblemished lamb or the your spotless calf or just the right bird to make it for an offering or a sacrifice, the one thing they all knew was, you know, in a few days I'll be back and I'll have to do it all over. Because that just was the way that they thought. And as a matter of fact, the priest, one of the things that made God so mad was that the priest understood that and they leveraged it against the people. And they used it to enrich themselves. And here were the spiritual leaders who were supposed to be looking out for the people, and they were just using the system to help heap more guilt on the people and make them think, well, I gotta go again. God's never really gonna accept me. And so there was no peace and there was no security. Peter tells us that Jesus died once for all. Jesus died once for all. Once for all what? He died one time for all sins, past, present, and future. Jesus, when he was on the cross, what's the last thing he said? He said, "It is finished." What do you mean? There's not going to have to be any more sacrifices. That's why you and I, as Christians, we don't have to go back to the Old Testament and go, okay, well, I committed this sin. That means I gotta get an unblemished lamb, and I gotta take it over here to the temple, and I gotta have the priest kill it and splatter the blood on the altar and that kind of thing. Because Christ died once for all, and there is security in that. And you can know that though you are not perfect, though I'm not perfect, our sins are covered because of Jesus. That security is a basic, fundamental need. It's what we're all looking for. We all want to know that what I have today is still going to be there tomorrow. And we find that in our relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Then he goes on. There's one other thing that we need to notice here. Let's just skip down to verse 51. Jesus says, "I am the living bread that came down out of heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread also which I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." Then the Jews began to argue with one another, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" So Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, You have no life in yourselves. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who eats me, he also will live because of me. This is the bread which came down out of heaven, not as the fathers ate and died. He who eats this bread will live forever. What does it mean that Jesus is the bread of life? It means that he is the sacrifice for our sins in our place. He is the sacrifice for our sins in our place. He was the perfect, sinless sacrifice on our behalf. We know, the Bible teaches, that sin, in God's sight, demanded the death and the shedding of the blood of the sinner. The death and the shedding of the blood of the sinner in order to satisfy God's righteousness. So, what does that mean? That means that when I sinned, God really should have killed me. When you sinned, God really should have killed me. But he didn't do it, did he? Because what would that have accomplished? Wouldn't have accomplished anything. Because I'm a sinner. What good would it do God to kill me? I'd just be dead then. So here's what God showed me a few years ago, and this thought has stayed with me. In God's sight, he looked at me and he said, you know, Ken is he's sinful. He's not worth killing. But in the person of Jesus, he said, he may not be worth killing, but he is worth dying for. And so Jesus took my place, took your place, as the bread of life, to be sacrificed on our behalf. And so, you read, just a few chapters over in John, you can read this in other Gospels. During the moment when, or during the time where we, what we know, or what we call the Last Supper. Remember what it says Jesus did? You've probably heard your pastor say this at your church when your church is observing the Lord's Supper. It says Jesus took bread. What did he do? He broke it. And he said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Jesus, as the bread of life, is the sacrifice, the one who was beaten, the one who was crucified, the one whose body was bloodied and bruised and battered in our place, because God's righteousness and his wrath demanded death and blood for our sins. So Jesus is the bread of life. He is our satisfaction. He is our security. He is our sacrifice. Now, real quickly, let's talk about Jesus, the resurrection. That's in John chapter 16. And it is, he makes the statement in the, John chapter 11, I'm sorry, y'all. It's happens, and he says it within the context of the death of his friend Lazarus. You remember the story? This man Lazarus, his sisters were Mary and Martha. Jesus was close to them. They were friends of his. He hears that Lazarus is sick and maybe at the point of death. He's teaching a little ways away, and he says, okay, we'll get over there when we get over there. And he waits a couple days. And then finally, after a couple days, he says, okay, guys, we need to go to Bethany because we need to check on Lazarus. He's asleep. He's gone to sleep. They're like, well, if he's asleep, that'll help him get better. They say, he's like, no, you don't understand. He died. And so they go, and he's 2 days late. And both of these sisters come to him, and they say, you know, Lord, if you had just been here, I know that my brother would still be alive. But he's dead now. And Jesus asks Mary and Martha, he said, do you believe that you'll see your brother again? And they're like, oh, yeah, we'll see him again. We know there's a resurrection. We believe that there's a resurrection. And that's when Jesus says, I am the resurrection. I am the resurrection. What does that mean? What does that mean for us? Jesus is the resurrection. I want to point out two things, then we'll be done. First of all, it means Jesus is the culmination. He is the culmination of the gospel. Jesus is the resurrection. It's the culmination. It's the completion of God's plan in redeeming people, us, to himself. But don't be mistaken. Jesus wasn't plan B. Jesus was plan A. I used to always think, you know, well, that the Old Testament was plan A, you know, the law. And it's like, okay, well, plan A didn't work, you know, because God somehow blew it. Plan A didn't work, so they had to come up with this other plan, and there was Jesus. But really what it was is that Jesus was plan A all along. The law was just sort of temporary to get to the point where Jesus would come. But Paul said when it got to the right time, what God did is said, okay, now it's time for me to really reveal the plan that you sent to Jesus. And that's what we have through the Gospels. Jesus was plan A all along. Jesus, as the resurrection, is the culmination. He's the fulfillment of the gospel. But Jesus as the resurrection is also the call or the challenge to us. I want you to think about something. Why? Why do you think we in the modern church, the evangelical church, why do we talk so much more about the cross than the resurrection? We do. We talk a whole lot about the cross, and we should. I'm not putting it secondary. We should talk a lot about the cross, but I'm not sure that we talk enough about the resurrection. And I think we talk more about the cross because when you think about the cross, it puts us in the position of receivers. Because what Jesus did on the cross, we go, okay, well, that means my sins are forgiven. And it does. We're like, man, that feels good because my sins are forgiven. And it's about what he did for us. But when you think about the resurrection, that leads you to, now I've got to live. And it's no longer, see, the cross is about gratitude. The resurrection calls for change. The cross calls for gratitude. That's why we're always saying, thank you, Lord, for the cross. Thank you, God, for sending Jesus to die. And we should do that. But the resurrection calls for surrender. The cross is Jesus stepping down into our darkness to rescue us. Jesus overcoming death is him calling us to live in the light of him, to have a new standard of living, to look at the world a different way, look at ourselves a different way. It really and truly calls for change. When the disciples, when all they knew was the cross, it didn't really change them. When they saw Jesus die, that didn't really change them. As a matter of fact, after they saw Jesus die, what's the next thing we see the disciples doing? They're locked in a room because they're afraid, they're dejected, they're fearful, they're in despair. It seems like it's all falling apart. It didn't really change them. But then they see Jesus and they realize he's alive. We saw him killed with our own eyes, but he's alive, and that's what changed them. That's when they really began to have a new sense of life and a new sense of purpose. When all they knew was the cross, they locked themselves in the room. Why? Because they were thinking, we killed Jesus. Maybe we're next. Maybe they're going to come kill us. But then, this is awesome to read in Acts. Then when they met the risen Jesus, and they knew that he was alive, had gone back to heaven, and they start carrying out the plan of spreading the gospel, telling people about Jesus. They went from being locked in a room thinking, oh my goodness, they're coming after us, to, we don't care what y'all do to us. You can beat us. You can threaten us. We don't even care if you kill us. All we know is we saw him killed. We saw him come back to life. And so we're going to follow Jesus. We're going to tell people about Jesus. We're going to live for him. Kill us if you want to. See, it was the resurrection that changed him. It's the cross and the resurrection together. You can't have one without the other. They work together because we find forgiveness and we find redemption for our sins in the cross. We find challenge. We find the call of Christ to a different level and standard of living. When we realize he is the resurrection. When you realize he is sovereign over death and life. He's the bread of life. He is more than just our hope for resurrection. He is the resurrection. So our challenge is to live the resurrection life that he gives us. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for your word and these truths. There's so much more that can be said. God, there's so much more for us to learn. But we thank you for these few minutes that we've had to think about it. Help us to understand, to realize the significance of Jesus as the bread of life, of Jesus as the resurrection, of Jesus as the only way, of Jesus as the truth, and all the other things that will be studied and mentioned in the coming weeks, Lord. May they penetrate our hearts and minds and make us more of who you want us to be. Thank you for these students. Bless them in their studies and their time here at Shorter. Use them to be leaders on this campus. Use them, Lord, to be the light of this campus to their fellow students, to members of the community. May they bring joy. May they bring peace. May they bring the light of Christ wherever they go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, y'all. Thank you.
Salvation, this free gift that we cannot earn, but was freely given to you with the death of your son Jesus on the cross. And thank you, Lord, that you are the only one that can resurrect, Lord, that you are the resurrection and the life, that you are the bread that fills us when we hunger, Lord, that you fill us spiritually and physically with whatever we need, that as your word says, you supply all of our needs according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And we thank you, Lord. Use us to do your will and raise up people, Lord, all around the world to speak your word in truth and love. And thank you, Lord, for Ken and the message that you gave to him to speak to us tonight, Lord. And just thank you for each and every person who's here today. And let this message just soak in our hearts as we go throughout each week. And not to forget the gift that you've given us. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen.
Amen.